Today's first reading is from Malachi, chapter 3, verses 1 through 4, and can be found in the Pew Bibles, but I don't have that page number, I'm sorry. See, I am sending my messenger to prepare the way before me, and the Lord whom you seek will suddenly come to his temple. The messenger of the covenant in whom you delight, indeed, he is coming, says the Lord of hosts. But who can endure the day of his coming, and who can stand when he appears? For he is like a refiner's fire, and like fuller's soap. He will sit as a refiner and purify of silver, and he will purify the descendants of Levi and refine them like gold and silver until they present offerings to the Lord in righteousness. Then the offering of Judah and Jerusalem will be pleasing to the Lord, as in the days of old and as in former years. Our second reading is from Luke, chapter 1, verses 68 through 16, or through 79. Blessed be the Lord God of Israel, for he has looked favorably on his people and redeemed them. He has raised up a mighty Savior for us in the house of his servant David, as he spoke through the mouth of his holy prophets from of old, that we would be saved from our enemies and from the hand of all who hate us. Though he has shown the mercy promised to our ancestors and has remembered his holy covenant, the oath that he swore to our ancestor Abraham to grant us that we, being rescued from the hands of our enemies, might serve him without fear, in holiness and righteousness before him all our days. And you, child, will be called the prophet of the Most High, for you will go before the Lord to prepare his ways, to give knowledge of salvation to his people by the forgiveness of their sins, by the tender mercy of our God. The dawn from on high will break upon us to give light to those who sit in darkness and in the shadow of death, to guide our feet into the way of peace. The word of God.
When people are asked what the word church means to them, some people will say, well, that's a place of judgment. It's a place that makes you feel guilty. It's a place to stay out of. But other people talk about churches as a place of love and grace and mercy. You can find all of these words in the Bible, and while this church tends to err on the side of that love and that grace and that mercy, you need all the different parts of it to really be faithful to the Bible. Malachi, like many of the prophets, seems to put most of his emphasis on the judgment side. Nobody really knows who Malachi was. The name means my messenger. And he talks about God's messenger. Likely it was written in the 5th century BC, but no one's sure exactly when. And he was writing to people who were living through a really difficult time. Some of them were being brought back to Judah, which was their ancestral homeland, but they had been exiled. They'd been taken out for a long, long, long time. The people had been taken out. Some of the folks had been allowed to stay there, but it was a whole different place. They lived through some really tough times. Strangers had been brought in to take the place of those who were taken out, and customs and culture had changed a lot, and there really wasn't this sense anymore of tradition. Even though it was the homeland, it didn't feel like home to a lot of people. And the people that were living there weren't really following God's ways anymore, where once they had felt this close intimacy with God and this ability to do what God had asked them to do, all this chaos had interrupted that. The transmission of how we do things and who we are had been lost. And so it really was an uncomfortable place. And in the midst of this, Malachi calls the people to account. We need to get back to these ways. We need to understand and do them. So he has both good and scary news for the people. He says that a messenger is being sent by God to prepare the way for the coming of the Lord. So good news, right? The Lord is coming. This is a good thing. But Malachi says it's not going to be easy. Who can stand when he appears? Malachi asks. He's talking about the messenger. And he says the messenger is going to be like a refiner's fire or like fuller's soap. And those things burn. Fuller's soap is like bleach. And of course, fire burns. They wouldn't be something you'd want to have come upon you. But there's a word of hope in them because they purify things. When a refiner's fire goes and works on a substance, it burns away all the stuff that's not at the core, the things that aren't really important. And it often leaves something very, very shiny as the pure substance that remains. Something that you could see a reflection of the refiner in it. If God is at work refining and cleaning things up, then perhaps no less than the image of God will be restored among the people that Malachi is talking to. Malachi says that the people will become righteous. This purifying fire is going to do that. And then that initial loving covenantal relationship that they had with God is going to be restored. So there's good news, but it sounds like first there's a lot of difficult, maybe even scary things that are going to happen. So we have to fast forward now 400 or 500 years to Luke's time. The passage we read there is this beautiful, hopeful, tender passage. It's the voice of the priest Zechariah speaking to his newborn infant son, John. Zechariah's wife, you may remember, had been unable to have children. And in those days, that was kind of a scandal. The women were looked upon as, you know, something must not be quite okay about the way you've lived your life because you aren't able to bear children. They were getting old. They'd given up on the dream, really, of having children. And one day, Zechariah was alone in the sanctuary doing his priestly duties. There were lots of people outside praying around the sanctuary, but he was alone inside when an angel of the Lord appeared to him. And just like most people in the Bible who see angels, he was terrified. And the angel, like most angels in the Bible, said, "Don't be afraid." It's interesting, isn't it? People are always terrified when they see the angel, and then the angel always says, "Don't be afraid." So the angel tells him, your prayers for your wife Elizabeth have been answered. She is going to have a son, and you are supposed to name him John. He's told that the baby is going to be very, very special, because even while that baby's still in the womb, he's going to be filled with God's Holy Spirit. When he grows up, he's going to turn many people of Israel to the Lord their God. He is the messenger that has been spoken about all these years to prepare the people for the coming of the Lord. He and the Savior are going to be together closely in time, but John is the one that's up first. Well, Zechariah, you can understand, was kind of curious about how this was going to happen, given his age and the age of his wife. And so he doubted just a little bit. And the angel said, "Hey, this message is from God, and you are a priest after all. And since you are doubting God's word, you're not going to be able to talk about this for a little while." So John couldn't speak. And he leaves the sanctuary, and the people outside were wondering why he'd been in there so long. And then they realize that he can't talk, and they somehow understand that this means he's had an incredible vision. So John goes home. Elizabeth does become pregnant, and she keeps herself in seclusion for 5 months. But she knows that this pregnancy is a very special gift from God. And so when she and Zechariah take their son to the temple on the 8th day, as they are to do, to be circumcised, people assumed he was going to be named after his father or some other relative in the family, because that was the custom. So they ask about what his name is going to be, and Elizabeth says, "We're going to name him John." And the people say, "Well, that can't be right. You don't have anyone named John in your family." So they turn to Zechariah, who, of course, can't speak, and he writes it down. His name is going to be John. Well, all of a sudden, Zechariah could speak again. And the people, as people often are in the immediate presence of God, were scared because they realized God's hand was really in the birth of this child. Zechariah was filled with the Holy Spirit, and he spoke the words then that we read this morning. This child, he's speaking to the child, is a sign that God is raising up a mighty Savior for the people, the one that they had been waiting for so many years. This Savior is the one that the prophets had spoken about, the one that fulfilled the covenant that was made with Abraham, that the people being rescued from the hands of our enemies might serve him without fear. But first, this tiny little baby John, the child of Zechariah and Elizabeth's old age, would grow up to be the one that goes before the Lord to prepare the ways, to give knowledge of salvation to his people by the forgiveness of their sins, and to guide their feet into the way of peace. It's a big job. Notice that in Luke, this one who is to come would be the one whom the people might serve without fear. So we move from Malachi's sort of scary thing about this refiner's fire to this Savior who we can serve without fear. And you have to wonder, how do we get to that place of no fear when Malachi has said, who can endure the day of the messengers coming, and who can stand when he appears? Over the years of my ministry, sometimes people have asked me if Mark helps me write my sermons. I've always found that a curious question because not once have I ever been asked if I help Mark with engineering problems. So it sort of makes me wonder if when people ask, they don't quite think that I can write them myself. So I assure you I do, but the process of writing a sermon involves getting a lot of information. It is a big deal to be speaking about something like this. You want to be sure you know. So there's commentaries that I read and a clergy group that I'm in, and sometimes I even talk to my husband. So on Friday, we were driving down to Los Angeles. We had a lot of time in the car, and Mark teaches the fourth and fifth grade class at the mix. So they had been studying this passage from Malachi. So I knew he'd done some preparation for it too. So we started to talk about what it meant. I asked Mark if I could quote him because he said something that I found really interesting. He's quite open about the fact that he belongs to a 12-step program. And he said before he got sober, he would have assumed that Malachi meant you're guilty of something and you're going to be punished for it. That's what this refiner's fire is all about. You're in trouble. Fuller's soap, like I said, is like bleach and fire burns. But Mark said now that he's worked a program, he knows that you can't get to the place of no fear and peace that Luke talks about, where we serve the Lord without fear, unless you've gone through this refining process, which is sometimes painful. Many of you know that in the 12-step programs, one of the steps you take is to make a fearless and searching moral inventory, meaning that you get really honest about who you are and the things you've done that maybe you aren't so proud about. And then you have to tell someone else, usually your sponsor. You have to read the whole thing to them. Most people assume that this is going to be really hard and really awful, and they worry that if they tell the sponsor everything they've done in their life that they're not proud of, the sponsor's going to say, wow, are you a disgusting person? I don't want to see you anymore. But the sponsors have all done this step themselves. They know what it's like. They know what was in their inventory. And usually they don't bat an eye. Sometimes they even say, that's it. That's the worst you've got. Together, the sponsor and the sponsored person set about planning how the sponsored person is going to make the next step, which is to make amends to the people they've harmed. Repent actually means not just to say I'm sorry, but to do something about it, to make amends, as long as doing that doesn't cause further harm. So knowing that you've confessed to a sponsor and the sponsor didn't end the world right there gives you courage to take that next step. Often, as people make amends, they find that they are forgiven by the person that they are apologizing to. And sometimes they even find that the harm that they think they've caused, that they've carried a load of guilt about, isn't even remembered by the person that they thought they were harming. Once all this amends making is done, a tremendous burden is lifted and the person's freed from a whole lot of stored up guilt that they'd been carrying around. They no longer have to be afraid of what someone might find out about them. They've been through this refining fire. Next week, we're going to hear about more about John and how he served as that refining fire. He was really tough in what he said to people, and he sounded pretty scary. But he was urging the people to do this process, to confess, to make amends to God from whom they had wandered away. And that is really what repentance is all about. He was calling them to take that difficult step so that they could indeed be ready to serve Christ without fear. For they were going to discover that in Christ, their sins had been forgiven. We live in a time when the words sin and confess are wildly unpopular. We don't like to do those things. We like to think of ourselves as pretty good people. And we often rebel against the idea that confession, certainly publicly in a group, is even necessary. But there's a book that's called You Are What You Love. It's by James Smith. And he talks about how we get in the habit of doing things. And it's the things that we love to do that are easy to make a habit out of. And he talks about how that applies to church, and particularly this idea of confession. He has an interesting theory. You all may remember that in the 1980s, suddenly we started talking about mega churches. Those really big churches that often met in warehouses, they had coffee bars there, and they had loud music, and they were very, very popular. One of the ideas was that we should be, as churches, seeker-sensitive, that we shouldn't be focusing on the people that already know what Christianity is about. We should be working to attract the people who don't know much about that. And we want to encourage them to come and have a good time so they'll come back. To make it comfortable for people to do that, the church had to be less churchy, Smith says. It had to be exciting, familiar in some ways, so it didn't feel strange, and it had to be really cool. Smith says that ideally the church would feel like a mall and like a concert, and like Starbucks, all rolled into one, because those are places that people like and places where people feel comfortable. So we saw churches meeting in warehouses. We saw Starbucks in the back. We saw the wonderful bands. Traditional songs and liturgies were out because they talked about the old stuff that you had to know something about. The Lord's Supper was considered too weird for people who didn't understand what that meant, and so it was out too, or altered, to make it more comfortable for people. As Smith said, worship was supposed to have less wrath, more happiness, less judgment, more encouragement, less confession, and more forgiveness. For hundreds of years, worship had included group confession, and then the assurance of pardon, which is what we call the good news that in Christ we are forgiven. That really is the good news that we received in Christ's life, death, and resurrection. But if you don't have anything you've done that needs to be forgiven, you really don't need that good news. It's actually kind of boring news because you don't need it. If you have nothing to confess, you don't need the good news. Smith makes the argument, and I think he's right, that deep down inside of us, All of us know there are ways where we have fallen short of the vision that God has for us. And all of us actually long for that sense of being truly known for who we really are and being forgiven. He says that as churches began to leave out that process of confession and assurance of pardon, we may have removed the one thing that's really necessary. Instead, most of us walk around with that sense of, if you all really knew who I was deep down inside, you wouldn't want to be around me. Confession gives us a way to clear all that up. Our Catholic friends understand that. And to free us to live with peace and joy because we know that we're a forgiven people. John came in sort of a scary way, telling the people to repent of their sin and to get ready for the coming of the Lord. He did scare people with what he had to say, and that's not my favorite way of convincing people that they might want to be Christian, but it worked for him. In the long run, he pushed them to think about who they really were in relation to God and who they wanted to be when they met this coming Savior who was finally on the horizon. They were invited to surface things that had weighed them down for years to bring them to the light of day, and then to find out in Christ they didn't have to carry that burden any longer. They could worship the Lord without fear, just as the prophets had said, because they were going to be forgiven through Christ's grace. That's good news for them, and it's good news for us. And it's exactly how we're invited to prepare our hearts this Advent season. What burdens do you need to let go of? What guilt have you been carrying around that could be surfaced and then released? This is something we all need, and we wind up in a better place when we do it, but you can't get there from here without going through this refining process first. That is the way that leads to peace. It's the way God's given us. Thanks be to God for this time of preparation. Amen.